So we've seen that the Bible commands us to be engaged very robustly, very vigorously in the defense of the faith, in giving an answer to our critics, in helping people to understand the truth claims of the Bible, Christianity, what is the truth. And so that is that. And then also we've seen that the Bible teaches us how to conduct ourselves while you're dealing with apologetics, that we are not to be arrogant, we are not to be impatient with people, we are not to be, you know, too much noise, like we know it all, we are not to be engaged in a contest, ego context, intellectual context, and so on and so forth. So, really, there is that case there. Now, what I want to do now, at this moment in time, is to give you examples both from the Bible as well as from church history that apologia, apologetics, was at the heart of Christian ministry. That's what I want to do now. I want to convince you that apologia, apologetics, was at the heart of Christian ministry. In the ministry of the Lord Jesus, in the ministry of the apostles, and also onwards as you go along in church history. Now, there is no doubt that the Lord Jesus Christ engaged in apologetics from time to time. No doubt about it. You remember when he healed that woman on the day of the Sabbath, the woman with a humpback. And the Jews came and told him, "You do know it's a Sabbath. Why would you be healing on a Sabbath?" And Jesus has to defend why he is healing on the Sabbath. And his apologia, his apologetics is this: man was not created for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was created for man. Is he giving a reply? The Lord is engaged in apologetics. In John chapter 10, John's Gospel chapter 10, verse 30 to 35, and then 38. Now, I want us to look at that one. I want us to look at that one. John's Gospel chapter 10, verse 30 to 35, and then we're going to read verse 38 as well. John chapter 10, verse 30 to 35, and then we're also going to read verse 38 as well. Verse 35. Oh, sorry, verse 30. My Father who has given them to me. I and the Father are one. 31. The Jews picked up stones to stone him. Jesus answered them. Jesus answered. Because he's been challenged, isn't it? So he answers. Now we said apologia is simply to give an answer. Jesus answered them, "I have shown you many good works from the Father." You've seen them. They should convince you from the Father. "For which of them are you going to stone me?" The Jews answered him. Of course, they also engaged in apologia. They answered him, "It is not for a good work that we are going to stone you, but for blasphemy, because you being a man, make yourself God." So they have accused him, haven't they? "You are a mere man, how can you call yourself God?" Jesus answers, apologia. Jesus answered them, "Is it not written in your law? Haven't you seen it in your books? It's there. Go find it. Is it not written in your law? I say you are gods. If you call them gods to whom the word of God came and the scriptures cannot be broken, do you say of him whom the Father consecrated and sent into the world, you are blaspheming because I said I'm the Son of God?" So the argument is, if mere judges, but this is referring to Psalm, I think, Psalm 82, verse 6, I think, Psalm 82, verse 6, where he says, you are gods. And the people who are addressed as gods there are mere judges. They are judges of men. Because they exercise authority in behalf of God, they are being referred to as gods. Jesus is saying, if mere human beings can be called gods, how much more the one who has come from heaven himself? He's relating ideas, isn't it? If human beings can be referred to as gods, how much more the one who comes from heaven? Think, reason, apologia. Jesus is engaged in apologia here. Verse 38. No, let's just go to verse 38. But if I do them, even though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. So what he's saying is, I have done some miracles which no other human being can do. So you don't believe my words. Who does these things except the one who has come from God? Who? See? So the Lord frequently was engaged in apologia. And we could go on and on with that. But it's not the Lord only, is it? It's not the Lord Christ alone who was engaged in apologia. Now, look at Acts chapter 17, verse 2. Acts 17, verse 2. Now, again, we are concerned with this, because people have said, we don't need to give proof of our faith. We don't need to argue about our faith. We don't need to defend our faith. The Holy Spirit will defend it. No, but Jesus does defend his faith here. 17 verse 2. And Paul went in. Now let's just begin from verse 1. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in, and as was his custom, it was his custom, ilikuwa desturi yake, it was his custom, he did this frequently. And as was his custom, and on three Sabbath days, what did he do? Come on, read for me that one. What did he do? Akahojiana now. English? He reasoned with them. From where? The scriptures. Verse 3. Explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead. And saying, this Jesus whom I proclaim to you is the Christ. So he's engaged in apologizing, in apologia, that the Christ who came is the one the scriptures talked about. He reasoned with them. Look at chapter 24. Acts of the Apostles, yes. Chapter 24, just go forward. So Jesus was engaged in apologia. Paul is engaged in apologia. Should we be engaged in apologia? Thank you. We should. We really, really should be engaged in apologia. Chapter 24. Verse 25. Can somebody read that for me, please, if you can?
And as he reasoned about righteousness,
yes,
and control, uh-huh, and the coming judgment,
yes,
Felix was alarmed and said, go away for the present. When I get an opportunity, I summon you.
So he reasoned with them concerning these subjects, isn't it? He reasoned with them about righteousness and about self-control and about the coming judgment. He reasoned with them. Felix, the king here, and so on and so forth. And Felix says, go away, Paul, go away. By the way, there was a time he argued so much in front of Agrippa. Actually, go to verse chapter 26. See how Paul is in the presence of Agrippa. You know, he has appealed to Caesar, hasn't he? Verse 1. So Agrippa said to Paul, you have permission to speak for yourself. Okay, I'm engaging apologia now. You've been accused in my court. Defend yourself. Give a rebuttal. Give an answer. Give a defense for yourself. Oh, and then Paul begins in verse 2, doesn't he? I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, I am going to make my defense. Do you see how Paul does it? He's gentle. He's polite. He doesn't dishonor the king. He says, King, I am very fortunate. I'm very lucky that I'm going to defend myself in front of you. He's trying to soften the king to hear him, isn't it? It's like, had it been somebody else, they would not have had me. But you, King, I know you're a reasonable man. He says here, I consider myself fortunate that it is before you, King Agrippa, I'm going to make my defense today. My apologia. Against all the accusations of the Jews, especially because you are familiar with all the customs and controversies of the Jews. Therefore, I beg you to listen to me patiently. And then verse 4, he begins apologia. And that apologia goes very long. It is very long. Oh boy, it keeps going. Verse 19. Therefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared first those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem. And he goes on and on and on. Verse 21. For this reason, the Jews seized me in the temple and tried to kill me. To this day, I've had the help that comes from God. And so I stand here, testifying both to small and great, saying nothing but what the prophet and Moses said would come to pass, that the Christ must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and to the Gentiles. Ah, that apologia was so strong, was so detailed, was so cogent, was so intellectually reasoned, that look at the response of King Agrippa in verse 24. And as he was saying these things in defense, Festus said a loud voice, Paul, you are out of your mind. Your great learning is driving you out of your mind. But Paul said, I am not out of my mind, most excellent Festus. You see, he's calling him most excellent Festus. He's still respectful, still polite, but putting forth his case. For the king knows about these things, and so on and so forth. Ah, it's not just Festus, not Festus only. Look at the response of King Agrippa in verse 27. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know that you believe. Verse 28, and King Agrippa said to Paul, in a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian? Do you think by this short apologia, you're going to make me a Christian? So really, I'm going to tell you, it is not the apologia that makes people Christians, right? You could present an apologia. I will talk to you next week about the distinction between what is this? This is getting me right now. I'll tell you. Maybe it's something to do with defense and persuasion. Okay? Ah, proof and persuasion. Those are two different things. You could actually prove your case, yet not persuade people. Who persuades people? We'll talk about that. Okay?
Does have a yes.
Who does?
Agrippa,
yes. Yes. You almost persuaded. I think Geoff Thomas has a message on that one. He calls it almost persuaded. There are people that will preach to, they are almost persuaded, but not quite, isn't it? Because at the end of the day, it is not the proof you bring. It is not the intellectual defense. There has to be something else. Anyway, we'll talk about that. So again, you see Paul is engaged in a defense of his faith in apologia. Now, thirdly, we've talked about Jesus, we've talked about Paul. Ladies and gentlemen, church history is replete, by replete meaning it is filled with apologists engaged in apologia. Remember, when talking about church history, we talked about the accusations that came to the Christians back in the day, that they were cannibals, isn't it? A cannibal is somebody who eats human flesh. And why were they accused of cannibalism? Because they were saying, we are eating the body of Jesus Christ. Now, obviously, that's a malicious accusation, or at best, an ignorant accusation. They must give a reply, isn't it? They must give a defense. And so they say, no, we don't mean it that way. We mean it symbolically. In apologizing, in giving an apologia for their faith. Some of them were accused of incest, having sexual relations between brothers and sisters, because a husband would call his wife my sister in the Lord. And they say, how can he be your wife if he's at the same time your sister? They don't understand that. So an apologia must come. Do you know, in a very large extent, somebody like Dr. Luke was an apologist. Both of his writings, the Gospel of Luke and Acts of the Apostles, are written to one person called Theophilus, who we think was a very important nobleman in Caesar's house. And the reason Luke is giving for writing the Gospel and for writing Acts of the Apostles, he said to Theophilus, that you may be persuaded about the things you have come to believe. Where you have doubt, I want you to remove the doubt. This is what happened. Apologia. Now remember, we talked about Justin Martyr. Remember? Irenaeus. You remember these people? Tertullian. These were great Christian apologists. Every time the Christian faith was questioned, they defended it. People like Athanasius. Remember, in the Arian controversy, a question was brought about whether Jesus is fully God. They have to defend that. So throughout Christian history, you find apologia through and through. So number one, we are saying the Bible commands us to engage in apologetics. Two, Jesus engaged in apologetics. Three, the apostles engaged in apologetics. Four, church history is filled with people who engaged in apologetics. Now I'm going to say a number of things here, and I want you to write them down. Why then it becomes necessary for us to be engaged in apologetics. We're just continuing this. Why then it becomes necessary for us to be engaged in apologetics. Now, ladies and gentlemen, reason number one, you understand there are many religions in the world. Is that true? Is that true? Hinduism, Islam, Scientology. There are many religions. And all of those religions claim to have the truth. And as we live in a society which is multi-religious, that is to say, it's got many religious persuasions, from time to time we will be called upon to insist and to give proof that Christianity is the only way to God. It is not one of the ways, but the only way. That Islam doesn't take you to God, that Hinduism doesn't take you to God, but that Christianity is the only way that takes us to God. So the very fact of many religions in the world necessitates the need for apologetics. That's one. It's not very difficult to understand that, yes? Two. Two. The emergence of diverse or divergent viewpoints, the emergence of divergent viewpoints challenging truth claims of Christianity. The emergence of divergent viewpoints challenging the truth claims of Christianity. It's not just many religions, but there are viewpoints now. Viewpoints, simply opinions, isn't it? One of the viewpoints, I think that a very clear example, is the theory of evolution, for example. The Bible tells us that God created the world in 6 days. Ex nihilo, creation ex nihilo, creating everything out of nothing. Evolution says, no way. The things we see came out of a very big rock through a process called the Big Bang. And they are now telling us that we can actually trace the existence of matter to what they are calling a point of singularity. And they have an experiment now, they are calling the God particle. They are reducing the atom, trying to break the atom to its minutest possible form. And they are saying they are going to prove that out of that small, minutest form arose matter as we understand it. It's ridiculous. But it is being taught in our schools, in our colleges, in our universities. People are embracing it as an alternative truth, quote unquote. So we are gradually coming to a point where we will be called upon to prove that creation is a fact and that evolution is a false theory. Those arguments on ID, intelligent design, cosmological arguments, teleological, we'll discuss this, don't worry about it. Teleological arguments, arguments from design, arguments from purpose, you know, moral arguments, arguments from morality. When we're engaged with those, we are giving proof that if there is no God, then there is no right and wrong. There is only what is done. Truth becomes relative. Because when you say it's wrong, who decides what wrong is and what right is? Those are called moral arguments for the existence of God and for creation. Intelligent design, ID. You cannot tell me that that camera our brother Wilfred is using now just happened. I mean, how could it happen? It has a flap that is closed, and then there's a hinge with a flap. There is a button for start and stop. There is a memory card that is inserted in. Surely, the very design of it tells you an intelligent being designed it. So the fact that we have trees and the complexity of the plasma and the cell structure of the tree and the cell structure of, we're talking about intelligent design, ID. When we argue like that, we are engaged in apologia. And so on and so forth. So the emergence of divergent viewpoints, challenging truth claims of Christianity, like evolution, a new age, for example. There are many viewpoints, by the way, will call us to engage in apologia. Number three. Difficulties within the Bible itself. Call for apologia. Now, there are people who have observed difficulties within the Bible. Is that true? For example, they tell you, Matthew said this, but Luke said this. There does appear to be a contradiction in terms of what they say. Yeah? The Muslims in their public meetings sometimes will call those that they call in contradictions. They will say, Chronicles says it is the Lord. I think that there was that thing about David numbering the people. Is it the Lord who caused him to number the people, or is it the devil who caused him to number the people? I think in Kings and in Chronicles, in one place it is God, in the other place it is the devil. That seems like a contradiction. You can't talk about the same thing and say two different people have done it. Well, we have a way of explaining it, obviously. For example, when Job, Satan comes to destroy the health and the property of Job. Well, here on earth, who is doing the destruction? Satan. But who has allowed it? So there's a way you can explain that, isn't it? It's like saying, I have an employee who is feeding my cows, isn't it? And taking care of my compound. Well, when you come, you will look at my cows and say, hey, Pastor, you've taken very good care of these cows. Oh, and look at the way you've looked at, and you're correct, isn't it? I am the one doing it because I'm paid. But am I the one holding the slasher? So you could actually say, I'm the one doing it, but you could also say, it's the servant doing it. There's no contradiction, depending on where you stand as you look at it. Now, all I'm doing here is engaging apology. I'm giving a reason for what appears like a contradiction, isn't it? So there are difficulties in the Bible that have led people to think the Bible contradicts itself, therefore the Bible cannot be trusted. And Kevin will be called to give an apology and to say, no, 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 you got it wrong. You got it wrong. The Gospels many times have differences in the way they look at things. People say, you see, Luke says this. Matthew says this. Who should we trust? See, the Bible itself is confused. No. It's not. When I come to give an apologia, I will say something like this. It's the same story of the four blind men who went to see an elephant. And the one went and touched the elephant, the leg. And he couldn't, you know, his hands could not connect. And he left saying, oh, an elephant is very big. My hand could not connect there. Well, he's giving part of the truth. But is he giving the whole truth? Not the whole truth, because he's blind. The other one came and touched the trunk and said, what? An elephant is so strong. Well, that's a truth, but half of the truth. All you need to do is to harmonize all of them to go to get the complete picture. God showed the gospel writers different angles of the Lord, and they all saw it differently. You can harmonize that. When you go to Kilimanjaro, you can go from the Kenyan side, Kajiado, Ilasit, Loitoktok, a border called Ilasit. When you go there, you see Mount Kilimanjaro. Well, you can sit there and see even. And then you go from the Tanzanian side, you'll see it differently. It's the same Kilimanjaro. Me giving you a report that doesn't sound like the report Ben gave you does not mean we are contradicting each other. We only saw different sides of the mountain. Again, what am I doing here? I'm engaged in apologetics. So that whole idea of difficulties within the Bible mean we will be called upon to engage in apologia time and again. Number four. Attacks on the Bible, attacks on the Bible, comma, the church, comma, Christianity, attacks on the Bible, comma, the church, comma, Christianity, and even the truth itself, oftentimes will call us to engage in apologetics. There are some things we do that the world doesn't understand.
Yeah.
I repeat. Okay. Do I need to repeat 5 times? Attacks on the Bible, Christianity, the church, and even the truth itself, right, will often call for us to engage in apologetics. We've already given examples of church history where Christians were accused of being cannibals or being people that practice incest. Were those claims true? No, they're not true. But they are attacks because people don't understand something we do. A practice we conduct, they don't understand it. So what do they do if they don't understand it? They misrepresent it. They mislabel it. So we have to correct the mislabeling. We have to correct the misunderstanding. No, that's not what we believe. No, you misunderstood that. When we talk of the Lord's body, we don't mean the Lord's body literally. We mean it figuratively, symbolically. When we do that, we are engaged in apologia. Was that number 4 5? 4. 4, okay. Number 5. Distortions to the Christian faith. Distortions to the Christian faith. Distortions to the Christian faith. Now this is basically distortions to the Christian faith. These are basically things that we have to deal with within our own ranks. People who have the name Christian but are misrepresenting Christianity. Isn't it? And sometimes we are judged by them. We are put in a one basket and judged wholesale. We must stand up and defend the true Christianity. Number 6. Is where we started. Okay? Number 6, where we started. The scriptures command us to engage in apologetics. The scriptures command us to engage in apologetics. And of course, we quoted 1 Peter 3:15, yes? The scriptures command us to engage in apologetics. The scriptures command us to engage in apologetics. Number 7, and the last. 7. Again, here is where we began. This study, that is a study of apologetics, this study stimulates and encourages, this study stimulates and encourages the habit of critical thinking. This study stimulates and encourages the habit of critical thinking, comma. This study stimulates and encourages the habit of critical thinking, comma, which is necessary for both hermeneutics, which is necessary for both hermeneutics, which is necessary for both hermeneutics as well as homiletics. Which is necessary for both hermeneutics as well as homiletics. Now write this under the same point if you can. If you cannot think, you cannot preach. That's something my teacher Keith and I told me, and I've always held on to it. If you cannot think, you cannot preach. 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 Preaching requires that you're able to relate ideas. You're able to induct and deduct. You're able to present a case and make a conclusion. Like I will tell you, preaching is the art of persuasion. And persuasion means you are engaging with logic and reasoning and proving, providing facts so that somebody agrees with you. And only after agreeing with you, then are they able to do that which you desire them to do.